Okay, so it's 2:30, so we'll start. And let me tell you something. Okay, so in this course, I'll tell you something about a circle of problems that is actually studied by some part of quantum field theorists and string theorists. And that circle of problems encompasses the following topics. We are looking at the what we call supersymmetric field theories, gauge theories. With supersymmetry in various number of dimensions, on the one hand, we are trying to understand exact correlation functions in the theories. These exact correlation functions are in quantum theories. And by exact, I mean that not only we are trying to sum up effectively all Feynman diagrams, but also to take into account the non-perturbative corrections and sum over all of these non-perturbative corrections. And in some situations, for certain observables, that's possible, and the answers can be computed exactly. On the one hand, and they display a rich mathematical structure and connect to other topics. So one particular connection that we'll be doing in this course of lectures would be to integrable systems. So that's completely integrable systems. Integrable systems of classical mechanics. And the quantization of these systems. Okay, so since I was asked to give this series of lectures for non-experts, let me give a broader picture first and give an introduction to supersymmetry. So for that purpose, I want to have some feedback from the audience to understand what I'm saying is well known to everyone or what's not. So let me ask a question. So if I write that list of dimensions, so real dimensions of a manifold M, what would be special about this list of numbers? D equals 3, D equals 4, D equals 6, D equals 10. Do many people recognize it is a special list of dimensions? Not really. Okay, very good. So then my first lecture is not useless. And we'll talk about what's special for our real smooth manifolds of these dimensions. Okay. So to start with, let's consider a vector space or affine space. Affine space V and a symmetric bilinear form on it. G. So for simplicity, first you can think about V to be just a complex space. And G is a symmetric bilinear form on that complex space. Now,
so V is
a
complex number?
What's that?
But the field is real or complex?
Complex. So for start, you can think about field to being complex numbers. Then we can restrict it to real numbers. Okay, just analysis is a bit simpler for supersymmetry over complex numbers. First of all, let's recall what is Poincaré. What is Poincaré group of the square VG? Well, it's just isometry group, and we'll call it iso. So it's just an extension. Of SOV, of orthogonal group defined by that metric, by the translations of V. So that's a semi-direct product. The orthogonal group by the translation. Now, the idea of the supersymmetry is to generalize the structure of the Poincaré group to the superspaces or supermanifolds. So for that, one introduces vector spaces and does thing vector spaces of non-commuting statistics, namely that the coordinates in those spaces are anti-commuting, and we'll call them Fermionico-Grassmann. And if you have some vector space U where the coordinates are usual bosonic, so that X commute will denote PU, the space with the same structure but fermionic coordinates, so they anti-commute and call that P parity change. And parity means statistics in physical language. So let me define the super Poincaré. Super Poincaré group. Well, first let's do at the level of algebra, namely super Poincaré Lie algebra. So what is a super Lie algebra? Well, it's just Z2 graded Lie algebra, and that means that it splits into the bosonic part and fermionic part, which I called here G0 and G1, that's degree 0, degree 1, and so that the elements of G0 are commuting elements, elements of G1 are anti-commuting elements, I mean, before we impose the structure of the Lie bracket. And that means that the Lie bracket, from G, yes, to G, so it's supposed to be, so if you count the statistics here, so it goes from 0, 0 to 0, from 1, 1 to 0, or and from 1, 0 to 1. So then G1 is G0 module. So if you fix the bosonic subalgebra of the super Lie algebra, then G0 has to be the usual Lie algebra, and G1 has to be a representation of that usual bosonic Lie algebra. That's one thing. And another one from here, we recover that to have a Lie bracket defined on the odd elements, so also I called these elements even, and this element's odd. Yes, so to have Lie bracket defined on these odd elements, since they are anti-commuting, then the definition of Lie bracket implies that this map from the grade 1, 1 to the grade 0 has to be symmetric. So the Lie bracket restricted to G1 is a symmetric map, G1 times G1. The G0 symmetric. Okay, so this is just general general definitions about superlie algebras. Now let's apply that to the super Poincaré, to the construction of super Poincaré algebra. Okay, so let's see what would we want to take for the G1, for the extension of the Poincaré algebra. Well, we want to consider spinors space S, and for now S would be just is a Clifford algebra module. For the Clifold algebra of the vector space V and the metric G. And the Clifold algebra is what physicists call the algebra of gamma matrices. So you take just a free tensor algebra of V and you quotient it. And you quotient it by the relation that V to 1 to that V times V is the bilinear form computed on at that element V times identity. Okay, so it's well known that if you take the degree 2 subspace in that Clifford algebra, then the generators of it, like antisymmetric elements of the square of V, they act on the spinors. They act on a representation of the Clifford algebra in the same sense as spin representation of S of V, or more accurately, one should put it here, spin V, which is double cover of the S of V. Okay, so now let's take the vector space to be V plus S. And that's what we'll call super Poincaré. That's symbolically can be summarized that this is isometric group of this superspace, which is an extension of the ordinary vector space V by the space of spinors. Okay, now, so what about Lie brackets here? Well, the Lie bracket, to define the Lie bracket, let's look at this structure. So we have the isometric group of this space splits as follows. First of all, you have isometric group of V. That's the usual Poincaré. So that's Poincaré. And then it extends by the generators in that spinor space. So the spinor space is naturally a module of the Poincaré algebra. We know how to act on spinors by rotations of V and the by SO of V and the translations act by zero. So to finish the definition of this algebra, we just need to define this Lie bracket in the degree one, and that has to be a symmetric pairing. So we have to introduce so to give a Lie bracket here. In degree one, we need to introduce a symmetric pairing, namely symmetric map, yes, from S times S to V. Okay, and that would be the odd bracket. In the super Poincaré algebra isometry of F plus S. Now, okay. So what's special about d equals 3, 4, 6, 10, where d is dimension of V? Well, namely, in these dimensions, there is exists a representation this is d. Exists representation of a super Poincaré algebra I saw of V plus S. Namely, there exists a suitable spinor module S slanted such that, well, that representation is called, which is called minimal vector multiplet, and vector multiplet means that the bosonic components of this multiplet transform as vectors, and in addition there are super partners which are obtained by action of the odd generators of the super Poincaré algebra on the vectors are fermions called the super partners of fermionic partners.
I mean, this even part of the representations are vectors.
Yes, even part of representations are vectors, and odd part of representations are fermionic spinors of
vectors. Massless vectors.
Yes. Thank you. Yes. So, minimal massless. And fermionic partners are spinors in S. So, mathematically, this is captured by the following observation. Well, there is a theorem. It goes to Brink, Schwartz, Scherk. Of 77. And it tells the following. Well, there is a necessary condition for existence of that representation, which is summarized by this three-spinor rule, how it's usually called in papers, and is the following. Consider this bracket, let me denote it by angular parenthesis, from S times S to V, which is just the Lie bracket on the super Lie algebra, but it's odd, I mean, it's symmetric bracket because S is an odd subspace. Okay, so, and the three-spinor rule means that this equation holds true. The sum over cyclic permutations of the bracket between two spinors, psi 1, psi 2, which are elements here. So that gives a vector. And then you can act by that vector on the third spinor, psi 3, where this action means Clifford algebra action. So Clifford algebra action means that, well, if you, in terms of gamma matrices notations of physical literature, if you have a vector v mu, you can, contracted with the gamma, which is gamma mu, and act by that on the spinor. Take that on Psi 3. Okay, so the three spinor rule is a condition on this odd on this odd bracket. Which is that the sum over cyclic permutations of such three spinors vanishes. And the theorem is.
It's not Jacobi identity.
It's not Jacobi identity, no. No, it's not, because here we have a vector and we act by that vector by the Clifford algebra action.
Is Jacobi identity it's automatically satisfied?
Jacobi identity is automatically satisfied. Yes. No, it's not a Jacobi identity. Just look here. We have a Clifford algebra action by a vector on the spinor, and it's not the action in the Lie algebra. In the super Poincaré Lie algebra, on spinors acts rotation group, but not translation. Translation doesn't act. So it's not Jacobi identity, and the non-trivial observation of a physicist from 77 is that only for dimension of V 3, 4, 6, 10 exist the spinor module of V. Such that this holds.
Two one also, yeah.
No. Okay.
I'm slightly confused. What was the definition of this symmetric map?
Of this symmetric map, well. I haven't defined it yet. I said that it can be constructed, and the theorem is that in those dimensions it can be constructed, and moreover it satisfies that condition. And let me actually answer the question in this question, since it's important. I was going to answer it, the definition of this symmetric map.
But S is not necessarily of minimal dimension.
Exactly. So. Now let's discuss what is S actually. Okay, so first of all, again, let's work over complex field and let's V to be C to D and recall what is Clifford algebra of V. So it can be, okay, in terms of generators, let's say it's generated by gamma mu, which satisfy the anti-commutation relations, so just just in components the definition of Clifford algebra of that abstract, which is written in the upper corner of that blackboard. Now it's well known that it has a representation if D is even. So it's represented on the space of spinors, which can be decomposed into the spinors of positive and negative chirality, and it's represented. Okay, and S is C to D over 2. So gamma matrices are 2 to D over 2 by 2 to D over 2 complex matrices that satisfy that commutation relation. So and S plus and S minus are reducible. So this guy is irreducible spin V modules. So if you like Dynkin Lie algebra notations, then if D is even, we are talking about SOD. Yes, and those S plus and S minus modules are the modules that have the Dynkin weights here in this node or in this node. I mean, where you put one here or here, and zeros everywhere else.
But you assume that D is
If D is even, exactly. If D is even, then we have positive and negative chirality spinners, and that's what they are. And in terms of gamma matrices, or in terms of Clifford algebra, there is a projection operation. Well, projector. Okay, not literally projector, but let's say chirality operator. Chirality operator. It's an element of the Clifford algebra that anti-commutes with all gamma mu, and it's just gamma 1, gamma 2, and so on, gamma d. Yes, and the S plus and S minus are plus minus 1 eigenspaces of this operator. It's gamma, yes. Since we are not necessarily in four dimensions, that's called gamma star, which is a. Okay. If D is odd, then the representation, the spin representation, doesn't split onto positive and negative chirality. Yes, and you have just an irreducible representation of spinners, then S itself. So if D is odd, then S is C to T of D minus 1 over 2, and it's irreducible. Irreducible spin V modulus. Okay. Now,
I was actually saying, in even cases, C S is C to power of
C, not given, yeah, but two to power is not given, but it's two
to power of D over 2.
Oh, yes, thank you. Yes. 2 to T to D over 2. Thank you. Okay. So we have a Clifford algebra module. Now, on S, actually, let me fix notations a little bit, or maybe simplify it. Let me S without slant define to denote just the minimal spinner representation. So I'm sorry, I will remove the slant and I will use different font. So just that S is what's defined here, and the slanted S, like here, it will be the representation which is necessary to construct the massless vector, the massless minimal vector multiplet. And this S with slants exists only in 3, 4, 6, 10, 10, and we'll write it in terms of the standard spinners of Clifford algebra in a second.
Yes. These are modules of the even part of the Clifford algebra, or the spin group inside the Clifford algebra?
I'm sorry, I didn't hear quite question. S is a module of Clifford algebra.
Yes. Okay, but for example, in the even case, you made the split?
Yes.
And those are irreducible representations of the even part of the Clifford algebra?
Oh, sure. Sure, they are, but they are irreducible with respect to the complete one, because absolutely, because if you take the elements of odd degree here, like odd number of gamma matrices, and you add them by them on S plus, they map it to S minus.
Okay, but then this spin group inside the even part of the Clifford algebra,
yes,
is the real. You mean you want to talk about the real spin group?
So far, I don't want to talk about reality conditions. So far, just let me work over complex field. Okay, it's easier to analyze over complex field. So everything over complex numbers. Other questions at this point? Okay. So let me write the answer immediately here to keep it in mind and continue. So S for that list of D equals 3, 4, 6, and 10, the slanted S would be given as follow. It's just Dirac spinors. Well, as well, let me introduce terminology. This space S, that's what physicists call Dirac spinors. And its chiral subspaces in the even dimension are called positive or negative chirality Weyl spinors. Okay, so the spinors of that minimal vector multiplet in the dimension 3 is just Dirac spinors. In the dimension 4, they are again Dirac spinors, but they split, yes, as S plus plus S minus, because 4 is even. In the dimension 6, one takes S plus times one takes the two copies of S plus, so it's S plus tensor C2, or doubles the number of Weyl spinors, so the two copies of Weyl spinors of the same chirality. Yes, and in dimension 10, one takes S plus, so that's just Weyl spinors. Okay, we are working, again, I stress, over complex numbers. If I want to work over real numbers, then there are certain Majorana conditions that have to be imposed on these spaces. But to understand the lecture, we don't need to stick on it. So let me write the dimensions. Dimension of S. Okay, in the dimension 3, this is just let me just write the test as complex spaces. So in dimension 3, we have just two component Dirac spinors. In dimension 4, we have four component Dirac spinors. In dimension 6, we have four component Weyl spinors, but we tensor that with C2. So that's C2, 8. And in dimension 10, we have, 2 to 5, that's 32. And S plus takes half of that. So that's 16 components.
Is tensor or direct sum?
Weyl spinor.
In 6.
Tensor. Two copies. So the result is of dimension 8. Okay. Very well. Now let me give it as an exercise in Clifold algebra. I'll verify that the following statement is true. There exist bilinear form, and let me call it of type 1, type 2, in even dimension, and in my notations it's type 2 only in odd dimension. The bilinear form on S, so that's from S times S to C, and let me call it bilinear form like that, which has, sorry, invariant, of course, invariant bilinear form, invariant with respect to that spin V action, which has the following symmetry properties. In symmetry type as follows.
You mean that it's four cases, yes?
There are one, two cases in even dimension, and
yeah, but if it's relevant to this four case special dimensions.
Oh no, that relates to not those special four cases. This relates to arbitrary dimension. Yes, this is just Dirac spinners. Yes, on Dirac spinners. Okay. On Dirac spinners, yes. So with the following symmetry type, well, actually, let me just a bit extend the definition of the bilinear form. Namely, if we have such bilinear form from S times S to C, then we naturally can construct a bilinear form. Bilinear form which takes two spinners and maps that to external powers of vector space V just by inserting a Clifford algebra action of the vectors from V on spinners. So in components, you take two spinners psi chi and map that to the bilinear psi gamma 1 dot gamma I 1 dot gamma I chi with chi, where here we take antisymmetric combination of the generators of Clifold algebra. So the exercise to verify is that such bilinear form of type 1, type 2 in even dimension and type 2 in odd dimension exists, and it has the following symmetry type. Namely, it's a symmetric type 1 is symmetric for R equals 0, 1 plus D minus 2 over 2 mod 4, and antisymmetric otherwise. So that's 2, 3 plus D minus 2 over 2 mod. Oh yes, thank you. Yes, K. Mm-hmm. Yes, and type 2 is symmetric for K equals 1, 2 plus the lower integer part of D minus 2 over 2 mod 4, and antisymmetric otherwise. So for the 3 plus the same, yes. Okay, so the the bilinear of type 2, it exists in even at odd dimension. So here I have written it just in terms of the integer part of D minus 2 over 2, which might be integer or half integer, but you take the maximal integer below it. So now okay, very well. So you take so to find those spinner spaces of the minimal vector multiplet, the straight S, we need to find the symmetric bilinear form on S. We need symmetric bilinear from S times S to the vector spaces, and that's the case of K equals 1. Yes.
Sorry, wait a second. I was breaking. k equals 0, 1 plus 0, and 1 plus d minus 2 over 2, or 0 plus d minus 2 and 1 plus d minus 2 over 2?
It's 0 or 1. It's 0 or 1 plus d minus 2.
Yeah, well, this bracket suggests different. Bracket suggests 0 or
1.
Or the sum of the number.
Ah, sorry. Maybe I put brackets here?
Yes.
Okay. But by that brackets, I meant that I want to take mod 4 of that whole thing. Okay. Okay. Okay, so let's take k equals 1. Yes. Let's take k equals 1. And let's see, why did we need to tensor in the dimension 6 as by C2? Well, if you take k equals 1 and d equals 6, then you find that both for type 1 and type 2 form, type 1 and type 2, bilinears on Dirac spinners as are antisymmetric. Antisymmetric at, at k equals 1 when you map that to vectors. So that's no good to consider, that's not suitable for the Poincaré superalgebra. And therefore, we can fix that and take as times C2, and just two copies of S, and extend the bilinear form by taking what we had on S, and just antisymmetric pairing on C2. So if you like, maybe actually if you like, let's tensor it by C plus its natural dual space C check, and here we have SP1. Symplectic pairing between C and C check. And for minimal one, okay. For minimal vector, it turns out that it's sufficient to take the positive chirality spinners and apply this construction, and that's what you recover as a super Poincaré algebra for six-dimensional theory. Okay, let me give a couple of remarks about those lists of dimensions, which maybe mathematicians could appreciate, the exceptions of those list of numbers, as follows. Anyway, other questions so far about the exercise bilinear form, super Poincaré algebra?
Performance, if you say it's module of B for algebra, but S plus is not module of B for algebra.
S plus is not the module of Clifold algebra, but
it's module
of the spin. Of the spin, yeah. But as we define super Poincaré algebra, we just needed to have a module of the Genot part and Genot part.
It's more than this. Yes, the Clifford algebra, which was your demo.
Ah, oh, okay. Yes. Yeah. Yes. But for the construction of the super Poincaré algebra, we just have to have it as a module of spin.
Gamma mu integer between S plus and S minus.
Exactly. Gamma mu integer between S plus and S minus. Yes. So gamma mu integer between S plus and S minus. Maybe.
But the algebra of the orthogonal types are each piece.
Yes. They are reducible representations of the spin. Okay. So let's say a couple of remarks about those special cases when the three spinner rule holds. Did you erase it already? But you remember the cyclic permutation of three spinors, bracket of two spinors, and then Clifold algebra on the third spinor vanishes. Let me write it again, it's important. Maybe you recognize something what you're familiar with. So you take bracket and that's Euler algebra, yes, psi 1, psi 2. I denote it by angle parentheses. Yeah. And then you act by the resulting vector using Clifford algebra action on psi 3. And we want the cyclic sum to vanish. So what is it about? Well, there is an observation which goes back to, it's quite an old one. I think it's the Kuga Townsend of 83. That those four special cases and the corresponding representation of the minimal vector multiplet, it relates to the list of the normed division algebras. So that minimal super vector representation or minimal super Poincaré relates to norm division algebras. It's just real numbers, complex numbers, quaternions, and octonions. And as well, if you like another connection, the topological one, that's also the list of is naturally isomorphic to the list of parallelizable spheres. So that's S0. Oops. Sorry. S1. S3. And S7. So the spheres are just the spheres of the imaginary units of those division algebras of norm 1. Yeah, so these guys is, they have dimensions 1, 2, 4, 8. And these are the spheres.
And you have to add 2 to all these dimensions to get what you...
And you have to add 2 to these dimensions to get that list of numbers. So, absolutely. So the dimensions D of, we call it in physics, n equals 1 supersymmetry. Yes, and the dimensions D is you add 2, you get 3, 4, 6, 10. Okay, and... And if you forget about spinors and just try to work in terms of division algebras, then that three spinor rule translate to the statement that the cyclic combination of their associator in this algebra vanishes. Now, the spinor space, the slanted spinor space itself can be identified as follows. So let's, for bold K, denote one of those division algebras. So it's one of R, C, quaternions, or octonions. Yes, and for the spinor space is slanted, we take k plus k, so two copies of k, and as you see, the list of dimensions, fortunately I deleted it, yes, but yes, I deleted it, but you remember it went like, no, the list of dimensions of S, yes, let me put it over there, so S was C to 2, C to 4, C to 8, and C to 16. And in terms of Dirac spinners, it was S plus times C2 and S plus. And, okay. And so that's for R C quaternions and octonions. And let me just not touch this blackboard to keep it in mind. Okay, so you can think about that spinor space of the minimal supersymmetry as two copies of the ground division algebras, k plus k. Okay, and then the Clifford algebra or actually here I didn't specify. Okay, now we are working over the ground field, the real numbers, and for the statement to be precisely true, we want to consider the vector space V with Minkowski signature, so it's R to D minus 1, comma 1, okay? So namely, for this signature, there could be imposed the real structure on those Dirac spinors on those lists that you have over there, such that the following isomorphism holds. So S as a real vector space is a real vector space of dimension corresponding to 4, 8, or 16 for these cases. Okay, so Clifold algebra action of R d minus 1, comma 1 on k plus k. So we should write it as 2 by 2 matrices with entries in k, and we'll write it as follows. So let's decompose R to d minus 1, comma 1 as follows. Let's take R to d plus R to d minus 2, yes, thank you, R to d minus 2 plus R to 1 plus R to 1, 0 plus R, 0, 1. So these guys are space-like and this one is time-like, and let me put coordinates here as y, x, and t, and then identify this R to d minus 2 with our division algebra. Okay, and then the action, the 2 by 2 matrices that act on the space are simply the matrices of determinant, are simply anti-Hermitian matrices of determinant 1. Namely, you write these matrices as x plus t, x minus t, y, and y conjugated. So this is times identity matrix. It's identity matrix, and this is the dimension of k by k. Well, so this is the element of the division algebra, and this is it's conjugated. So everything together, it can act on the spinors k times k. So this is the Clifford algebra action. Of element V from the space R to D minus 1, comma 1, that we have split V as y xt, that's from R to D minus 2, that's from R1, that's from R1, and R to D minus 2 we have identified with the division algebra.
But matrices make sense for octonions.
Oh, yeah.
For octonions, yeah.
It makes sense, yes.
You just have to check that the square of this one fits.
Yes. By the way, the determinant of this matrix, the determinant of this matrix is just the norm squared of this vector v. So if you compute the determinant, it will be Sx squared. Oh, maybe I want to, did I, t, x, yes. So it's squared, x squared minus, somewhere signs are wrong. So minus plus, no, I want to have it, yes, I think let me swap t and x and then it will work. Yes. It's just, it would be like that. T plus x, t minus x, then it will work. So it would be t squared, then it would be t squared minus x squared minus y squared. Okay, and if you take minus of that, yes, so it would be the v squared in r to d minus 1 comma 1 with the signature plus 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 minus.
So you get what is determinant for.
So v squared is minus determinant of that matrix.
Yeah. No determinants on the
diagonal is commutative. Yes. Just a times that minus this times that and you get it. Okay.
Yeah, so it was from this condition that you get this minimal vector multiplication. This representation,
yes? Yes, it came from this condition, from this one.
Which is some algebraic calculation which you don't show.
Which is algebraic calculation, yes. Yes, I didn't show you, no.
And what is the physical whatever?
Meaning of that.
Yeah,
what's right? Yes, so the physical meaning of that we are coming to that, yes. I'll tell you in a second. Yes. So the physical meaning of that is that there exists what is called a minimal massless vector multiplet. So there exists n equals 1 Young-Mills theory. So let's put it there. Okay, since some people who are interested in high structures are in the audience, let me tell you another remark how that relates to high structures in geometry. I mean, in a system for L-infinity algebras and all that stuff. It's an observation by Baez Huerta of 2010, not very recent. The remark by Baez and Huerta of 2010 is the following. Okay, so what we have? Well, so consider that that hyperspace V plus is slanted in those three special cases. Yes, v plus s plus straight s, and then this is symmetric bracket. Yes, which takes s times s, takes two spinors and gets a vector from them, and now. Now let me consider the following map. We call it alpha from S tensor S tensor V to C, which takes two spinors psi, chi, and vector V, and sends that to the bracket of psi and chi computed by this operation. Yes, and then contraction with the, using the metric is a vector v. Okay. Now you can think about such map alpha as a three cochain. In the Chevalier-Eilenberg complex, for the cohomology of the Lie algebra G, well, let's take G to be this one, the super algebra G, with coefficients in the trivial representation C. And the condition that this three-cyclic condition, so the statement is that the cyclic condition is equivalent, well, that's just a, almost tautology, it's an obvious, that alpha is closed. Alpha is cochain, is three cochain. Well, then another thing that you can Bayes and Huert observed is that alpha is non-trivial, so three cocycle, and alpha is non-trivial. Alpha is not G of something, so which means that alpha actually represents non-trivial element of H3 of GC, and given a non-trivial element of H3, one can use it to extend this super Poincaré Lie algebra in a sense of L-infinity algebras by the term in the degree 2. So with that extension, let me finish it here. So with that extension, it means that for that list, D equals 3, 4, 6, 10. And the super Poincaré Lie algebra V plus S slanted can be extended to the super algebra. In a sense, of L infinities, of an infinity algebras, is defined by goes to Schlesinger or Stashev, 85. But some people are very well familiar with it.
There is a two bracket and a three bracket.
There is three bracket.
Yes, but there is no differential between.
Well, the differential is from the Chevalier-Eilenberg complex. And that two Lie algebra, well, it relates to what pieces.
What's one dimensional space here?
Excuse me?
Standard by what? By one?
By one dimensional space, by
what
that's.
What one dimensional space, maybe? Because it's.
I don't remember.
Yeah, because it looks like. Yeah, I think by odd, yeah.
Well, it takes two spinors and one vector. And send this to. It takes two odd elements and one even element.
Yes,
yes, yes. Okay, and in physics, P picture. In physical picture, it relates to what a physicist called B field. B field, which is connection, which is like connection on U1 Jorb in superstring theory. I'm not going to expand on that. It was a side remark maybe to get you more interested in that special list of dimensions and special list of Clifford algebra representations. That's how their importance show up in physics. Okay. And then this time it's 3:36. Maybe we can do a short break with two parts of the lectures. Okay, so let's continue our journey on the list of 3, 4, 6 ten-dimensional spaces. So let's actually write down the n equals 1 Cyperneog Mills that I promised to you exist in those dimensions. Okay. So for start, let's consider just a flat Minkowski space. D minus 1, comma D, comma 1, and that super Poincaré the algebra, some matrix of V plus slanted S, where S is related to the norm division algebras by taking two copies of that. So what is n equals 1 Cyperneog Mills? Is the following theory. So it's the gauge theory. So the gauge theory means that you pick a gauge group. You pick G to be a compact D group. Slightly later, I will consider theories on more general manifolds than just R to D. So let me write a more general definition. So you pick a compact Lie group G, and you consider a principle G bundle on your spacetime. More generally, by X sub D, I will denote the spacetime of the theory. Principle G bundle on X sub D. So then you consider connections, the space of connections. Let me put it as curly A. Little connections on this G bundle. So connections can be represented by connection one forms. So let A be connection one form. After you pick a trivialization of the bundle, which means that you have covariant derivative operator, D plus A. Yes, and A is a one form valued in the Lie algebra G of the compact Lie group.
Not a supergroup.
Not a supergroup. No. I didn't have special notations for their Poincaré supersymmetry group. I just denoted as an isometry of vector space V plus S. Now I picked a compact Lie group, not a supergroup. Okay. the spacetime XD is supposed to be equipped with a Riemannian metric G. Well, that's if you are doing the theory in Euclidean space. I haven't fixed signatures more generally. There is a metric on the space XD, and then we have the Young-Mills functional.
So it's not really V, you make V rotation to have a
positive. Yes, and so sometimes I'm talking about V, but yes. Yes, we can do the theory in different signatures, and we can do it on different manifolds. I just to discuss supersymmetry later, I will specialize for V, but now let me just give more general definition. So let's XD be a manifold with a metric on it, not degenerate metric. Let's put it non-degenerate metric. Okay. Okay. So Young-Mills functional, as you'll know, is the following. It's a it's a map from the space of connections to real numbers. So what this is called the action. Yes, and that's the integral over the manifold XD of the volume form on it, which is constructed by the metric G. Yes, times the curvature of the connection A, the norm of the curvature of the connection A evaluated by the metric. Using the Hodge star, you can write it as FA wedge star FA. Well, then I don't need the volume for, but OK, then let me finish like that. Just norm of the connection FA, FA squared, the same as FA wedge star of FA. And we need trace, yes, so we need to peak also. We need to peak non-degenerate. Well, let me actually say positive. Positive bilinear form, invariant bilinear form, yes. On the Lie algebra G. So F is a two-form valued in G, and we take that with a bilinear form. Okay, it's understood here that the norm squared is taken with respect to that. Okay, that's Young-Mills functional. Now, super Young-Mills functional. So for super Young-Mills, now I will specialize to XD is R to D minus 1, comma 1. And I consider the super Poincaré algebra I saw of E plus slanted S. And we want to consider a functional which is invariant under that super Poincaré algebra. So for that, we need the space of fields to be extended by the fermionic fields. And now the fields in the Young-Mills theory. Okay, so this is the space of fields. It's that. It's infinite dimensional space. Now the space of fields for super Young-Mills theory is the following. Fields are, well, that's connections A, the same that we had before. Connection 1 form A. And for the fermions, we'll put a section psi of the bundle of the spin bundle in that representation, straight S, the spin bundle S over over x valued in the algebra G. It's a joint valued spinner. Depending on the dimension, it could be Dirac spinner, no, in four dimensions, or Dirac spinner in three dimensions. In six dimensions, it's two Weyl spinners, and 10 dimensions is just one Weyl spinner. Okay, so these are the fields. And the action functional is extended by the Dirac action. So actually, let me put also a coupling constant over there. 1 over g squared Young-Mills, 1 over g squared Young-Mills. So the action functional S of super Young-Mills is 1 over g squared. This number is called Young-Mills coupling constant, the integral of xd fa. Which star fa plus the Dirac kinetic term for the fermions, and we write it as follows. Thanks to the fact that we have a symmetric pairing, remember that from S to S we had a bracket which extends to V. It means that if you take two spinners, well, it's symmetric, so if you take one spinner psi. Psi, it's something non-zero. So here we consider psi with that bracket d a chi. Okay, that makes sense. Well, since we have a metric, it doesn't matter whether we send it to vectors or one forms. With the metric, we can identify that. So d a of chi is a one-form valued spinner, and then with the bracket we can construct it. So here in usual physicist notations it's denoted by the slash of the Dirac operator. Okay, notice that these definitions, they make sense on arbitrary smooth manifold with a metric, with a spin structure. Maybe I should be more careful and just say that we want the manifold. It's sufficient to have the manifold equipped with the spin C structure, not necessarily spin structure. And that means that there is an extra U1 charge of the fermions. But then the equations could be, the Young-Mills functional could be written down on arbitrary manifold with the spin C structure. So far, we've just written the functional, but we haven't said what's special about the functional. Well, the special thing about the functional is that at least in the one, the space-time is a flat affine space, we can make that functional invariant under super Young-Mills on R, say, d minus 1, 1 is invariant under super Poincaré the algebra. Isometry of V plus straight S. The super Poincaré Lie algebra, it acts on fields. So the translation generators and rotation generators act in the natural familiar way. I don't have to write the action of those generators. The odd generators, which are usually called Qs in the physical literature, so let Q be generators here. And let's say that an element, I will write an element of S as epsilon well, in some basis in epsilon alpha q alpha. So let's say that q alpha would be basis. Be basis in S. So Q alphas are odd in my conventions, and epsilon alpha is even. So epsilon alpha is even element of the even space of spinors S.
This is for general D or only in the observation case?
No, this is in a special case. The n equals 1 Young-Nose functional that I'm going to write down is for the special case. So, so that's for D 3, 4, 6, 10. Just in general, I'm trying to stick with the notations that straight S denotes that special case. Okay, now the transformations. So here are the transformations. The action by Q equals Q alpha epsilon alpha, where epsilon alpha is a spinner in a straight S on the fields goes as follows. Delta A is 1/2 lambda gamma mu epsilon. So let me write it actually in Clifford notations, but I think you can translate it to the notations of the odd bracket that we had before. Well, what stands here? Here you take Psi. So Psi is the field that you have in this theory, the fermionic field, the super partner of the bosonic field of the connection one form A. And epsilon is a parameter which generates a supersymmetry. Okay, so you take these two guides, and since you have a bracket from the two spinner spaces to the vectors, and you can dualize it to get a one form, then you have a map from psi epsilon to one form. So that's the deformation of the connection one form A and components, write it like that. Then the variation of the fermions is the following. It's minus 1/4. Here is you take the Clifford action of the connection one form F on the spinner epsilon. And that's it. The Clifford action in the components, FA is a two form.
Yeah.
Yes. So you can act by Clifford on the representation of Clifford algebra. So it's gamma mu on epsilon. Yes. Oh, sometimes people use slash notation for to denote the action of the Clifford algebra. Okay. That's it. So that's it so far. It's called on shell. On-shell representation of n equals 1 vector multiplet. And the words on-shell means the following. It means that the Young-Mills functional, S of super Young-Mills, is invariant under the supersymmetry action up to equations of motion, and equations of motion you can put it as ds. If you think about s as a function on the space of fields, then the variation of the super Young-Mills under the supersymmetry action is zero up to exact. Is zero up to ds terms. So which vanish in the critical points for physicists, the equations, the dynamics of the classical theory, and this slang on shell means that for free particles, they satisfy equation p squared equals m squared. That's called Mass-Shell. It's a bit outdated terminology, but we still are using it. Okay. Okay. Now, let's consider the following situation. Let me take a spinor epsilon. And consider the supercharge q epsilon squared. Okay, so by super Poincaré algebra, it generates a translation in the direction of the vector field V, which is bracket epsilon epsilon. Yes. Isn't that that bracket in terms of gamma matrices? It's epsilon gamma mu epsilon. So we call the vector valued bilinear, if you wish. Linear in epsilon.
And V is an infinitesimal translation.
Is a translation along the vector field V. Yes, yes, yes. Lead derivative along the vector field. Yeah. So roughly speaking, let's see how it works. If you take the field A mu, yes, you act by Q epsilon, you get that. Now, if you want to compute the square of the q epsilon, then you need to take the variation of psi. And when you take the variation of psi, you see that you get a curvature here times two gamma matrices times the third gamma matrix times epsilon. And then after a little manipulation with the Clifold algebra, so using that axioms of the super Poincaré algebra, namely that three spinor rule, you will find that the delta squared variation of A mu is the lead derivative of A mu, and that's IV. Let me write without indices. It's more nicer. So that's a contraction of the connection, of the curvature 2 form with the vector field V that gets one form. This is what variation of the connection one form is, and this is gauge invariant lead derivative along the vector field. Okay, similarly for spinors. Now let's discuss the construction of dimensional reduction. So dimensional reduction means the following. You start with the theory on the manifold XD and consider and take XD in the form M over D prime times V of D minus D prime. So where D prime is less than D. And you complement that manifold of lesser dimension by just a flat space, so that the total is of dimension d. More generally, you can consider a vector bundle over m d prime of dimension d minus d prime to construct a dimensionally reduced theories. So the dimensional reduction means that you consider that you write down your fields and action on the manifold XD, and then take all fields to be invariant along the translations in the flat vector space of the fibers of the vector bundle. And so you get a theory which depends only on the fields defined on the manifold MD prime. So we will call it dimensional reduction from XD to MD prime for such a product or more generally for twister product.
So it can imagine small torus and essentially all the constant fields will survive. Yeah, that's, I suppose. It can form a position.
Yes, yes, exactly.
Q epsilon, you mean what you wrote before, Q?
Q sub epsilon.
Alpha.
Yes. Yes. That's Q sub epsilon. Mm-hmm. Okay. So now let me consider the following situation. Let's consider dimensionally reduced theory, and let's pick Q sub epsilon. Okay, for that dimensional reduction, when you take xd as md prime, it's vector space of d minus d prime, and I want q epsilon to square to the Lie derivative by the vector field v, which has only components in the vertical direction. Let me, for the pictures, think about M as horizontal space and V d minus d prime as vertical space, the fibers of this vector bundle. And I want the vector field V to have components only along the vertical direction. Okay, so in the dimensional reduced theory, it means that dimensionally reduced theory on MD prime, Q actually squares to zero. And since it squares to zero, one can consider cohomological theory with respect to this odd differential, and this is what the situation when Q epsilon squares to zero is called. I think it goes back to Witten in 80s, cohomological field theories. Well, actually, in a sense, it was earlier. The early constructions generally rely not on supersymmetry, but on what's called QBRST operators for the gauge invariant functionals. Always have this. Can also be realized in a form, in a cohomological form. Namely, there are in the QBRST, the gauge fixing construction by what's called BRST complex, Q squares to a gauge transformation, and then if it is extended properly by auxiliary fields, it squares to zero. And the cohomology of the operator Q are gauge invariant observables in the theories with gauge symmetries. So this construction doesn't necessarily deal with gauge symmetry. You see, it deals with the super Poincaré Lie algebra with dimensional reduction. And so it applies not only to gauge theories, but to other stuff. So let's now take that list of examples, 3, 4, 6, 10, and see what we can do using this construction. Okay. Okay, so you remember the decomposition of D to two-dimensional space plus the space of division algebras, and that's what we will combine with this construction of cohomological field theories to get some nice cohomological field theories as follows. So xd would be the space in the form M D minus 2 times C or R2. So that's a two-dimensional space. Now I'm talking about real smooth manifolds. But I like to identify this two-dimensional vector bundle over MD minus 2 with a complex, with a one-dimensional complex line bundle by the following way. So we know that Q epsilon squares to the translation. I mean, not like that. No, we pick a suitable spinor epsilon such that it squares to the translation only in vertical directions. So V is along fibers. Along fibers R2. And another important point is that if you are V, the norm of the vector V is zero. That's always true. I mean, the general statement about n equals 1 supersymmetry transformation, and it follows again from the three cyclic spinor rule. So V is epsilon gamma mu epsilon, and if you can compute V squared, it would be epsilon gamma mu epsilon with epsilon gamma mu epsilon. And since you can cyclically permute that, and it's still the same expression, the sum of that vanishes, so it has to be 0 by 3 spinor rule. Okay. So so we always have the lead derivative along the null vector field, and in Euclidean signature it has to be a complex. Yes, and so if so, then in a suitable metric on this R2, in a Hermitian metric on that line, complex line fiber, V is just D over Z bar, where Z is a coordinate. Is a vertical coordinate.
What is the signature?
So now I'm taking the Euclidean signature. Euclidean signature. So it's Euclidean signature here and there as well. That's why you have to introduce a complex coordinate. So V is D over Z bar, and since metric has only components between Z and Z bar, yes, then the norm of this vector field is zero. Yes. So V squares to zero. Okay. Okay, very well. Now, recall that we have a presentation of the super Poincaré algebra using the decomposition of d-dimensional space into two-dimensional subspace and d minus two-dimensional. So that would be d minus two-dimensional, that would be two-dimensional, and we have identification of the tangent bundle. You can identify a tangent bundle of the 2D minus dimensional space with that is one of the real with one of the norm division algebras, so which has dimension 1, 2, 4, 8. Okay. And consequently, the supersymmetry transformations can be analyzed with respect to this structure. And it gives the following. Questions? Okay, let's continue. All Okay, so under the dimensional reduction to the D minus two dimensional space, we still have the same number of components of the spinners, of the spinners that I called psi, which are sections of the spinner bundle straight S. However, from the components of the gauge connection on the space XD, we get the gauge connection on the space M D minus two, and plus two scalars, which correspond to the components of the gauge connection along the two vertical direction. So after such reduction, A on XD gives the connection A on M D minus two and two scalar fields, usually called phi and phi bar. Which are the vertical components, yes. Which are exactly from vertical components. From A along the vertical components called V D minus D prime. And that's what we've denoted over there just as a C or as a rotation. Okay. Now, one can analyze the so such dimensionally reduced n cos one Young-Mills and on the space of these fields with fermions. And deduce that the integral, the path integral, over the space of connections, yes, and the space of fermions, in the super Young-Mills section, it localizes. Well, localizes in the sense of Atiyah Bode. But applied to infinite dimensions. So the infinite dimensional station was here discussed by Witten, and then in the math literature, it's, I think, by paper by Atiyah Jeffrey.
It's semi-classical.
So it's not, well, it's the statement that semi-classical limit is exact. Yes, that holds in that situation of the supersymmetry, which can be interpreted as a certain cohomological computation. Namely, namely we think about the differential Q, which squares to zero, as a differential in a certain complex of fields, and we think about the volume form, which we integrate in the path integral, as the Q closed form and then one can localize it to, well, one can localize it to what physicists called BPS configurations. Mathematically, there are sections of a certain vector bundle over the space of fields, zeros of section of certain vector bundle over the space of fields, and those sections of vector bundle over the space of fields are what physicists call BPS equations. So the finite dimensional cartoon of this localization procedure is a Poincaré Hopf someone else theorem that the integral of Euler characteristic, the Euler characteristic of a manifold, which is the integral of the Euler class of tangent bundle, can be computed by picking just a vector field, which is a section of that vector bundle, and counting the zeros of that vector field with signs. So that's what happens here. So it localizes to the integral.
When you write A, it is a D dimensional version of the D minus two dimensional.
Yes. So when I write here, A is the connections and those scalar fields, yes, to get.
So A is K value. A is a special, because you want T and D minus two is K.
Yes, so this A is K valued, and this is just scalars. Yes. Yes. So, okay, so it localizes on what? On what we call BPS configurations. Namely, it's a certain modulus space. It's the modulus space which, let me denote as M. The modulus space, the data of that modulus space is the space time manifold, the reduced one. The choice of supersymmetry transformation to construct the differential Q, the choice of the gauge group G, and here you would have, well, if you have some observable here, let me do it with an observable. The restriction of that observable to the space of such BPS configurations, and that observable here, it satisfies that Q epsilon and the observable is zero. Here it satisfies just the closeness condition that D of R is zero. So you integrate just a cohomological class in the Dirac cohomology on the space of BPS configurations. Now, concretely, yes. Dirac differential. So O is a differential, is a differential form on this space, just in the Dirac complex on M, and D is Dirac differential. Okay, so the BPS configurations, they come from this analysis. So remember that we had the equations that the variation of the fermions is F, which acts by Dirac, which acts by Clifford algebra on epsilon. And now let's consider these equations. This is the BPS equations. I mean, the variation of fermions is zero, is what we call BPS equations. So
delta is not zero.
Delta is not zero, no.
Delta
no.
A. No, delta of A.
Delta of A is not zero. So remember that delta of A is the gauge transformation along the vector field V. So here it will be just the contraction of that vertical vector field with the F, which is obtained by the reduction of the high dimensional theory. So for delta A, it will just give us the variation of phi, if I think, okay, if I've taken the convention, the delta squares to the Lie derivative along the vector phi. So that's gauge transformation by phi. Yes. So F menu, gamma menu, epsilon zero. Okay, now this analysis is in D minus two dimensional space. And you think about epsilon just an element of K. So the, you recall that S is KK. And pick for epsilon something from here. I'll take epsilon to be, for example, 1, 0 component, then Q epsilon squares that you can verify only to the directions along those matrices, T minus X, T plus X, and here would be zero, so it squares, so it's vertical. Okay. However, okay, now using the Clifford algebra, comma mu are units of the division algebra. And so these equations tell us the following, that the spinor epsilon is invariant under spin tangent to the manifold M by D minus 2. Minus two action is generator F menu. Yes? So F menu is an element of the external of the external square of the cotangent bundle of MD minus two. And so yes, and forgetting about the Lie algebra. Yes, so epsilon epsilon is not the Lie algebra acts trivially on epsilon. I mean, it's along all components of the Lie algebra. The equation holds. Okay, and that reduces to the following list of equations. Well, so let's now write down our favorite list. Okay, so the here we put D of the XD, 3, 4, 6, 10. Here we put M D minus 2. It will be one-dimensional theory, two-dimensional theory, four-dimensional theory, and eight-dimensional theory. And here I would put equation F slash epsilon is zero. Well, in the one-dimensional situation, you have just SO2 action and SO2 exon epsilon with a single generator, F12, and I'm confused. In one-dimensional situation, there is just no two forms. The space of two forms is empty. There is nothing to rotate. So in one-dimensional situation, there is no curvature, and the space of equations is just empty. Then in two-dimensional situation, there is one generator of the external square of the cotangent space, and that generator is SO2 generator, and it acts on epsilon. So the equations are just that F is zero. So here I'm putting F along, of course, this is the curvature along MD minus 2, yes. The curvature in that reduced theory. So F is 0. Okay, in the four-dimensional situation, okay. In the four-dimensional situation, so the space of two forms, let's say of R4, it decomposes as the space of a self-dual two forms plus the space of anti-self-dual two forms. And epsilon is acted by the SU2. So you have corresponding decomposition of the spin 4 as SU2 times SU2. So epsilon is acted only by one copy of that SU2, well, depending on our conventions where we've put epsilon here as a chirality, and therefore that one chirality, that is one part of duality of the curvature tensor, has to vanish. So the equations here are F plus is zero, where the plus is defined with respect to epsilon. Okay, and finally, for the actinionic situation, well, here we can write equations in terms of epsilon. I like more a different, more differential geometric presentation. Namely, these equations can be, it's easy to compute, the consensus of this equation is the following. Define the four form omega by the bilinear but the four form be linear, so it's gamma mu 1, gamma mu 2, gamma mu 3, gamma mu 4 epsilon. Yes, using the Clifford algebra action and the pairing between the epsilon spinors. So this is a four form is automatically self-dual four form, and the equations can be written as f wedge omega star is equal to f. And these equations are called spin 7 instantons. These equations are called just instantons. So spin 7 instantons in 8-dimensional manifolds, instantons in 4-dimensional manifolds. This is called just flat curvature. Yes. And here we have empty equations. So this is the list of the nice cohomological field theories that we can construct by dimensional reduction of n equals 1 supranormals by two dimensions. I'm doing this time. We had like a 10 minutes break, so maybe I'm finishing in 4 minutes. It would be, yes? Okay. Mm-hmm. Okay, so let me just write it again. Definition. So let M d minus 2 be smooth Riemannian manifold. And let me define the modular space M of M epsilon G as follows. It's the space of connections A on principal G bundle on MD minus 2. So G would be compact Lie group. Yes, which satisfy the equation P epsilon of F is 0. And P sub epsilon of F just denotes those equations. Yes. Just these equations. So in all those cases, they are given as follows. And epsilon is fixed, yes. And epsilon is fixed. It means that explicitly it means that in the two-dimensional case you have to fix nothing. In four-dimensional case you fix what you call self-dual forms, what you call anti-self-dual forms. You fix orientation. In eight-dimensional case you fix a self-dual four form, non-degenerate self-dual four forms, which relates to actonians by Kiley. Yes. So p epsilon of f is 0, and mod automorphism. Or that's the gauge transformation of the G bundle. Yes. So if you count the components, the number of equations here, well, it's naturally from here they're just identified with the imaginary units in this norm division algebra. So there is one equation here, three equations here, seven equations here, and the number of components of the connection is has one more component, but there is a gauge transformation. So overall, if you do infinitesimal analysis of this modular space, you find that the equations which define M are elliptic equations. So this modular space is defined by nice elliptic PD. And so, what that? And so it's finite dimensional. And therefore, it's finite dimensional. Yes. And therefore, it's finite dimensional. So and now we are coming to the modular spaces that are very liked by mathematicians and geometers. For example, take a two-dimensional manifold to be a Riemann surface, and here we are talking about the modular space of flat connections on Riemann surface in four dimensions. Well, if you take for four-dimensional manifold to be a complex manifold, then instantons can be rewritten as a holomorphic G bundle. So that will be the module space of holomorphic G bundles on complex two-dimensional surfaces. Well, in eight-dimensional, it's something more exotic. Well, people are working on it, but I'm not sure if there are some. Well, there are examples, but there is no more or less general theory for spin 7 instantons. But well, they exist. So this is that finite-dimensional, that nice finite-dimensional modular space. Well, in the generic point, it's a smooth manifold, but because of sometimes the section is not free, there could be singularities of this manifold. So if you're supposed to understand it in a sticky sense in geometrical approach. Okay, and now the statement about with which I'm finishing is the following. So let me just write that, write three lines here and finish. So the three lines are the following. If you consider n equals 1 super Young Mills on the manifold of the form m d minus 2 reduced, so okay, reduced n equals 1 super Young Mills to m d minus 2, m d minus 2 times s1, or m d minus 2 times elliptic curve. So here I mean the complete reduction in the sense I've defined before. Here I mean taking the manifold to be d minus 1 dimensional and reducing only one direction. And here I'm taking the manifold to be just the product of elliptic curve or Riemann surface of genus 1 of finite size, and not actually reducing, but just considering the theory on such product. Now, here q squares to 0. Here, q squares to the translation along this circle, S1. And here, q squares to the Dalbo operator, or anti-holomorphic vector field on elliptic curve E sub tau. And correspondingly, the space of observables, so observables in those three cases, they correspond to the following. Observables are in terms of the finite dimensional geometry of the module spaces. So in the first case, they are just Dirac cohomology of the module space M GM epsilon. Yes. In this situation, when we have added one circle, we need to consider the fields which are loop valued, and that means that you take the loop space of M and you consider the equivariant cohomologies with respect to this section. So it would be Dirac cohomologies equivariant with respect to the circle action on the loop space. That's infinite dimensional space. So let me put it as M to S1, and that's the loop space. And that's the same as K-theory. That's the same as K-theory. Of that modular space. Okay. And finally, don't have space here, so let me continue to here. In the elliptic case, we would have the cohomologies equivalent with the dz bar operator on the elliptic curve on the space of maps from the elliptic curve to the module space M. So let me put it like that. So physicists call it chiral. Chiral model or 0-2 model or Witten elliptic genus, there are many names, but the convenient name for that is elliptic cohomology with respect to the elliptic curve with parameter tau of the modular space MG epsilon. So that's what the n equals 1 Young Mills on those manifolds give access to. It gives access to the study of this cohomological theories. The other names are rational, trigonometric, and elliptic, as people see in the connection to the integrable systems. So let me finish here for the first part.